Okay, that should be hopefully fixed now. I've done the restart. Matt, you want to turn off your video to me just in case that's affecting
Sure.
anything?
Wonder how I do that.
Should be a camera icon somewhere.
Yes, there we go. Okay.
Right, good. Okay, so hopefully this time everything will be good for all you guys. I turned the bit rates down some more. So let's jump into the game.
This is free music that's still available. Oh my gosh, it's really loud in my headphones. Here we go. That music is from a free or like low cost licensing music repository. And every once in a while, I see it in a television advertisement for, I don't know, shaving cream or something. It's funny. It's kind of got a Monday Night Football kind of sound to it.
And to look at the preferences here, I've had to write down a cheat sheet for myself on a piece of paper just in case I forget any of these controls. There's more than 30 commands in this list here.
The key to really memorizing the EV keyboard commands in a hurry is go back to 1993 and play X-Wing kind of nonstop for about 3 years, and then all the keys would make sense. I basically played that game nonstop during that time, and so all the EV keys are very similar to X-Wing, all the targeting controls and weapons and things like that. When we did our audio visual test last week, I happened to a remark to that the EV menu is incredibly similar in layout to the Marathon menu, and I don't remember doing that on purpose. I think it was some sort of a subconscious assimilation of the Marathon menu, or maybe that was just the thing that we did at the time, the green grid of buttons.
In the spirit
The
of the
title,
moment, I'm going to call my ship
yes, that's good.
Macintosh.
This artwork here and the title screen were sort of the only major pieces of third party art that we, I think Ambrosia hired that out to somebody whose name escapes me, but I ended up cobbling together most of the rest myself, including this lovely thing.
Yeah, people in chat, feel free to ask any questions or comments that you want. I'm monitoring it while I play.
More free music or low cost music.
But we beat them.
We beat them. That's right. This game had no story up until about 2 weeks before we had to ship it. And then it was suddenly like, oh crap, we need something for people to do in this universe. So I threw together some stuff that was basically Star Wars, the good guys and the bad guys. And change the names around a little, probably. It's all this. It's the same story as most science fiction, but I guess people really like it because the story is so flimsy and threadbare that you have to use your imagination, and maybe that's sort of the secret of why people liked it. Oh, please dismiss it. It's so bombastic.
It's longer than I remember. This is really, really a lot of story.
Yeah, it really is. And
Someone in the chat asked if you've seen the game NAEV, which is one of the things inspired by Escape Velocity.
no, I haven't.
There's also another one. I'm forgetting the name of it. I'm sure someone in the chat will tell us in a bit.
I had a copy of a program called KPT Bryce, which was one of the very first landscape generators, and I went crazy with it. And I wasn't a good enough artist to render a spaceport bar, so there's just a button that says bar and a little text dialog box. At the time, I was playing a lot of a BBS game called, well, at this time and prior, I was playing a BBS game called Trade Wars 2002, which this is basically a BBS game plus Asteroids combined, coupled together.
I don't remember where anything is on the map, so I hope I haven't just accepted two things that are in completely different directions.
Oh, you're not bad.
I have. Oh, well.
No. One's close.
Yeah, let's head towards that one over there. Now I'm trying to remember how to do this stuff. So I got to get a certain distance away before I can enter hyperspace.
Mm-hmm. Have our lovely sound.
And then press jump. How long has it been since you last saw this game?
Well, other than a couple of weeks ago when I watched it on YouTube, it had been years and years and years prior to that.
How's it feel good to go back and see it again?
Well, what I was just thinking is, I wonder if people today playing would even have a way to relate to the sort of 2D motion of the game, you know, the thrust in a direction and then coast. I don't know if I've seen too many games like that lately that they use that mechanic.
Shift click on planets.
Of course, it's a route.
Oh, that's cool.
Oh, I don't think it'll let you because it
I haven't
doesn't
been there yet.
Yeah, I haven't been there yet. No, what do I feel looking at it? Well, it's very primitive, of course. I wonder why I went with the all green. Computer readout there. More low cost or licensable sounds, more of a dynamite sound there.
Where are we now?
Of course, in the later games, we added cool things like blinking lights and you know, jet thrust and things like that. What struck me looking at Eevee Nova last week was some of the graphics in that are still really good. They still really hold up, I think. These are basically cylinders and flat squares, which is all I was really capable of rendering at the time.
Oh, wow. Someone's just left a very long comment to you. I'll read it out for you. He says, Matt, I have to say that at a young age and growing up with RPGs like Final Fantasy and Pokemon, and some Mac games like Realms, this was probably the first game I had played to play a game where I could actually join up with and help the stereotypical evil empire. It was a very striking experience to me. This tradition continued with the Voinians in Override and the Federation in Nova. And he was wondering what inspired you to make this a possibility in each game.
Oh, interesting. Well, I wasn't the first one to do it. I'm sure I wasn't. I think it was just a part of, this was almost a sandbox game before there were sandbox games, wasn't it? Semi-open world. I guess it was mostly, I had two factions and I needed to double the amount of stuff to let you do. So, it was probably a expediency rather than any kind of literary duality or anything like that. I can't claim I'm that smart. But let's say I'm industriously lazy.
Another question, how do you feel about spawning a cult of EV Bible thumping religious zealots screaming on street corners about the foretold coming of EV multiplayer?
Well, I'm for it, although I haven't seen many Bible thumpers on street corners lately. I maybe I'm not on the correct street corners.
One of the things I always loved about the games was these little bits of text that come up when you're doing your missions. You know, they kind of put you more in the universe.
Sometimes they'll use your name or your ship's name. You know, basically simple search and replace the game is doing, which is hilarious.
You must be Shorty McPants. There you go.
Right. So when you use a silly name, it sort of breaks the illusion and it all comes crashing down. It's sort of the Oregon Trail effect. Error.
Prices are all high at this place. I should have been buying some commodities on the cheap before. So it's been a long time since I played this game.
Yes. Yeah, there was a lot of grinding at the initial parts.
Let me look at the map. See what's nearby. Yamuro, Kathoon. Or shall I just explore out?
I'm trying to remember what's in what direction. I don't remember the map of this game as much as I do of EV Nova.
I might just explore a bit more for now. Would help if I set a destination.
Yeah, nothing's really happening to you yet.
Didn't your wife threaten to cut off your fingers if you started working on another EV game?
I don't know about cutting off my fingers, but when I was working on the third one, my routine would be to go to my regular job, because at this point I was not in school anymore, and work a whole long day, come home, eat something, and then start working on EV Nova until 10 o'clock or midnight. And so she would go to sleep and I would be up, you know, working on the game until all hours. And these are the sorts of things you can do when you're 20, something that I can't imagine doing today. It's probably one of the reasons I didn't do anymore, is that I was probably a little tired of it after three. And also I got old and I can't stay up that late anymore. Sorry, guys. Of course, you're in a star system with no planets, which I guess is just a star. I never showed the stars because I didn't want it to be something that you would... they looked a little silly being tiny. I played with it at one point, having, you know, actual suns. But I couldn't make them very big because the game would get really slow. So I think it's just sort of assumed that the sun is there, you just can't see it.
Taking me some time to get reacquainted with all these controls.
I suppose in retrospect, it doesn't help that the starting ship is difficult to tell at a glance which way it's pointing. You should give me a more arrow-like beginner ship.
I want to go to this place. Yeah, I made some profit.
All right.
That's the grinding aspect of the game, where you just keep buying commodities cheap, going somewhere where they're expensive. Go west.
What can you buy for your ship? Anything good?
I could get a weapon.
I was watching somebody yesterday play the new Master of Orion game, or the early beta. And what's funny about that is the ship design section where you buy things for your ships looks almost exactly like this screen. I guess there's only a couple of ways to do it, but it took me back.
How do I jettison that stuff? Command K. Yeah, now I have a bunch of things. I love that little animation.
Little boxes.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, the shareware reminder. Now, am I correct that this still costs the same amount to register today as it did 20 years ago?
I think so.
That's actually kind of amazing. That's, I think, all controlled by the Ambrosia servers. You'd think it would be like 89 cents now, but I guess not. And yet, every once in a while, somebody registers a copy, and I get a couple of dollars. So thank you. Thank you, video game archaeologists of the world.
George's World. Love the name. Mysterious earthquakes everywhere. Very cool.
I don't remember the joke. That must have been some kind of joke that I don't even remember.
Oh shit. Oh shit. Oh shit.
Oh, it's THX1138. That's the joke. Yeah, there's a lot of kind of, ouch, semi-obvious planet names and things like that that are, I think probably in the time before the internet when a person could only get a certain number of them, it was funny. But now it almost seems too obvious because you could, you know, look up a list of them on a wiki page somewhere and think, man, look at all these dumb names. It's probably because I was pressed for time and I needed to create names of, you know, a couple of hundred star systems. And I ran out of names, so I started naming them funny things that popped into my head.
I just remembered how to talk to other ships.
Well, and they give you helpful commerce advice. That's nice.
Let's refuel.
I think it's funny that these planets are all, you know, they're often described as having big cities and things. But I couldn't render cities, so I, you know, they all look like, you know, barren, featureless deserts and oceans and things. I get, the camera's facing the other way, let's say that.
Okay, rush delivery. Do you remember which direction any of these places are?
I don't remember. I should have put a map on here. That would have been nice, wouldn't it?
Yeah, actually, I can cheat a little bit and make a little map progressional for myself. Put that in the top corner of my screen. Keep updating it periodically.
Oh, good.
Okay. Have we been to any of these places? We haven't been to most of these. So I don't know what direction everything's in.
Does it let you see the map now? Oh, there it is.
Thank you, chat.
I did it. Yes, it's the green thing. Okay.
No, they're getting further away. Oh,
ever further away. Oh,
that one might be doable. Okay, I'm going to try this one.
Let's do it.
Oh, I forgot to. just scrolling back and checking for things that people have asked that I missed. Why did you change the Manta graphic?
Change the Manta graphic. So those are little triangular ships, right? Did I re-render it? Did I make it look fancier? I honestly can't remember. I remember that was one of my favorites. Maybe I just came up with a prettier... you're in trouble now. Maybe not. Oh, you're being helped. I do remember I wanted to try to give the impression that there were other things going on in the universe by having other ships fight each other, which works to a greater or lesser degree. Yeah, stock up. So the cops come to town and clean house.
And I love the way later on you can really play all the different sides against each other. Just play the game however you want. Wow. Extremely dangerous place.
Yeah, no kidding.
Could probably do with some of something that will help me out here.
You're a bit poor. Yeah, currently
can't afford much.
Can't afford anything.
I could get some more weapons, but I don't know how helpful they'd be when I'm running away from every fight.
Yeah, I should have downloaded you a save file beforehand.
I could buy a map. Any ideas whether I should buy any of this stuff?
I don't know if you can afford very much.
I can afford a few things. I can get an auto refueler, a decoy flare, a map.
The flares never worked that well. I wouldn't recommend that. That was a cool idea inspired by, real jet airplanes that didn't translate so good to the game.
I cannot afford a RAM scoop, people in the chat. I guess we'll just move on for now. Okay.
Big battles. There you go.
Lots of money.
Well, you're doing well now. Those rush deliveries are great.
All right, I can make a little bit more money there.
Yes, perfect.
How much is the cheapest ship upgrade? 200.
Oh, yeah. Got a ways to go.
100,000. Okay, the scout ship's the cheapest. Yeah, got a lot more money to get now.
Yeah, you need to grind a bit.
Oh, that's why people are telling me to get the RAM scoop. Okay. I get fuel back as I play.
Great.
Okay, we're heading to Hunter now with some food. Anything? Let's buy some metal as well.
I'm just sitting here trying to think of the economics of hiring a spaceship to deliver 10 tons of food. that's like one truckload. I guess space travel is really cheap in the far future.
Someone was saying that one of the most memorable parts of the game for them is the two independent planets on the edge of the galaxy that seem to have some sort of blood feud going on. And he wants to know if there was an inspiration for this.
Which ones are those? I don't remember. Because I'm so unprepared.
I should have
found a way to do more homework. Oh, luckily you have your scoop because you're out of gas.
Yeah, I wasn't paying enough attention. I was busy reading the comment.
If you didn't have that, I guess your choice would be to beg mercy from a passing NPC.
Or eject. Yeah. Just float in space for a while.
Yeah, float in space. That's right. I do remember they extort you for a lot of money to give you free gas.
I don't remember what the threshold is.
When it turns bright green and you have one jump worth. So I think you're almost there.
I was always glad that the asteroids were just kind of there for scenery.
Yeah, they don't persist once you get off the screen. Once they get off the screen, they're mostly there as a hazard to missiles. Missiles have a tendency to bash into them rather than go where they're supposed to be.
I love how I hit the edge of the map on that one, and it just ran me down the edge.
Yes. I think in later games you would wrap around. There you go.
Oh, they don't have any metal to sell. Let's refuel.
I like the description for this planet. That's actually rather alarming. That's far away.
That's close, right? Yep.
Yeah.
Can I do close. The roots here? Excellent. Let's accept that. Oh, not enough cargo.
Oh, you have to sell back your, 19 tons. Well,
yeah, if I get rid of my metal, then I can take it.
Yes. So what's a rush delivery of luxury goods? Like, we're out of caviar. Hurry.
I might.
But it takes days and weeks to cross the galaxy in this game, so it would be not fresh at all. two planets. Well,
and they're a bit of a distance apart from each other.
Yeah.
Let's get to this one first. Clotho 2.
Ooh, ambient sound. Fancy.
I love the ultra green graphic.
Oh, yes. This must not be the planet you were meant to go to.
No, I didn't end up taking that mission.
Oh, no, you didn't.
I didn't want to jettison my metal. So I thought I'd just go somewhere else nearby.
Mm-hmm. That 10,000, that's not much.
Yeah. Thinking about going to Zaxted Starport. It's not too much of a trek.
Captain Hector.
He loves to remind you.
Yeah. How close are you to exceeding your shareware grace window with this emulator?
I installed this about 2 weeks ago.
Okay, so you're halfway into it. I think it would give you a month, and then it would become increasingly difficult to survive without just getting destroyed.
I should have a key somewhere.
Yeah.
I'm sure I have a registered version on one of my machines.
Oh, so that brings up an interesting tale. I told Richard this already, but people sometimes used to accuse me of ripping off a game called Elite. Well, of course, there's new versions of Elite now, but... of course, it was a well-known game, and I had a Commodore computer when I was growing up. And contrary to the accusations, I never played Elite. I did own a copy, but this was back in the days of physical copy protection. And I, at some point in the mere hours between buying my copy of Elite and trying to play it, you know, after school, I managed to lose the physical copy protection thing. It was like a prism, and you look through it, and it would unscramble codes on the screen, and you type it in, and you like it. So my entire exposure to Elite is reading the manual only, and not actually playing it. I still have yet to play it. I saw the screenshots in the manual, and it looked real cool. And there was a description of the universe, fly between planet, trade, you know, metal and luxury goods, and things like that. And so there was an influence from Elite, but it was mostly from the manual because I never actually got to play the real game. So the 20 years later, the my name is cleared, the record is set straight. Oh, you have to go around the long way.
Yeah, apparently so.
I think, unfortunately, in terms of riveting live streaming, a lot of the really interesting and good missions won't happen for you until you get a decent combat score.
Oh, well, we're trying to get as much money as we can here. Yeah. Actually, no, I'll just head there, see if I can pick up any more stuff. Not sure how much of a lag there is for you guys in the stream to what we're playing. I could buy some metal. No, that's a bit far away. Let's hope for the best. Oh, I don't have enough space. This tiny little ship. I'll deck myself out with some metal and we'll see how we go.
Oh, there's Captain Hector again. He gets progressively more annoying.
As far as annoying goes, it's pretty tame though. Just appearing in the bottom of the screen, right. Bugging you.
Right. Nowadays, I suppose this was the brand new game. These free-to-play games, but if you wanted to skip all this annoying grinding, you could just put $20 on your credit card and get a better ship right away.
So we're getting a bit of money together now.
Right.
Soon we'll be
able. How much do you need for your next ship?
I'll have to check. I think the cost was like 77,000, but comes down a little bit if you trade in.
The later games we added used ships, which was kind of an interesting mechanic. They weren't really used. They were the Atmos guys just created some interesting and unique new ships to buy that had lower price and interesting equipment. This must be very patient passengers, because you could have traveled around the galaxy for years with them on your shuttle and they wouldn't have complained.
Yeah, I love that element. Just take them on a real wild journey. Wow, food is really cheap here. Only 5. Let's check this rush stuff. I'm gonna hope that there's somewhere that has high price of food nearby. Let's see if we can cash in on that.
Profiteering.
Medium, or shall I go find somewhere?
Well, you can go from 5 to 120. That's a pretty good profit anyway.
Alrighty. Let's have a look at the shipyard. Oh, we got more options on this one.
Oh, yes.
Let's see if we can afford anything. We can afford a scout ship, a defender, and that's it.
And what are the stats on the scout? You can see the cargo and stuff. Oh, you can hold a lot more cargo.
40 tons
of cargo. Faster. Oh, yeah.
A lot more fuel as well.
I say go for it.
Yeah, a defender has very little space, but yes, can get into some combat.
I think, I'm not sure I'd want one of those in combat either. I remember they were basically disposable ships also.
All right, we're going to go with the scout ship.
Yes.
Trade-in value is pretty nice. What shall we call it?
What's your cat's name?
Max.
All right. Well, that's not a great name for a ship.
Starship Max.
It's a great name for a cat, but... yeah.
Someone in the chat says call it Brexit.
Brexit, yes. At the time of this recording, we don't know how the Brexit is going to turn out.
Now, we have a bit of money left. We can buy something.
Ooh. Should we get... Now, if you want to...
Get a RAM scoop.
If you want to trade more, you could invest in more cargo space. Cargo pod. So that adds 10.
And it takes up...
20.
Yeah, it takes up quite a bit of the... Mm-hmm. I could buy some more weapons. Anyone in the chat have thoughts on what we should buy? An escape pod.
The escape pod is really only useful if you're playing in strict mode, where it deletes your file if you die. The escape pod is sort of a get out of jail free card for that.
That's an awful lot to take in, really, in this.
Oh, yes. Well, there's a lot to read.
Yeah.
If you've not seen any of this, you could spend hours just reading the flavor text.
And the last time I played this game, I only put in a few hours, so I remember very little. Let's go to the cargo pod for now and get on with it. Anything nearby?
Mm.
Can try and go to there. Plateau.
Anything you can load up on while you're here?
Equipment's nice and cheap.
Oh, yeah. Good.
Maybe buy one load of metal. Leave a little bit spare just in case.
Wise.
Jeez. Hard to see on that tiny little ship. It's so thin.
Oh, and it turns very quickly.
Craig Fryer is in the chat.
Hi, Craig. Oh, my.
Oh, what's this?
It's a lot of Federation ships. Confederation ships, sorry.
Brexit, you're cleared to land. So Craig Fryer is co-authoring part of this book, if anyone here is not aware of that.
Sounds like a great opportunity to segue into talking about the book while you grind food deliveries. And yeah. I, for one, am looking forward to reading about the secrets of the many games that I liked playing. Did you get a chance to talk to the Bungie guys? Last time we spoke, you were trying to hook that up.
Yeah, I've got onto some of them now.
Terrific.
I should pop into this planet. So I'm talking to Alex Seropian over email. I recently got onto Matt Sowell, who was one of the earlier employees. first visited by the colony ship marathon. Very.
Speaking of Bungie, I didn't plan that.
Can I land on this little one? Yeah. Yeah, and also onto Doug Carlston. Doug Zartman, rather. Doug Carlston is the protobund guy. And yeah, through them, I'm trying to get onto a couple more.
Terrific.
There's already a. There's so much stuff you can find about Marathon and, and Pathways into Darkness online. The Marathon story page by Hamish Sinclair is incredible.
What a repository that guy's site is.
And I've been hoping to talk to him, but I don't know if he still checks the Gmail that he has listed on the page. Sell the medal. Ben and Harry's new flavor. I've been getting through a lot of interviews for the book. It's been really exciting talking to all these people. Getting all the backstory to games that were more influential than they really got the credit for.
Is there still anyone out there that you just haven't been able to get a hold of that you'd really like to talk to?
Yeah, there are still a few, I think. Try to remember off the top of my head.
I hope everyone is still alive and breathing. It's been long enough that one wonders.
Unfortunately, there are people who have passed on that I've wanted to talk to. The guy who was running, what was the company name? One of the Mac Flight Simulator companies. The guy who was behind it died of cancer, I think. That was quite sad. There's someone else who died as well. I have a few questions that were asked to me here. Tim Phillips, who did Realms and some other RPGs, maybe... he's on the list of people that I would like to get in touch with to see what he can tell me. I haven't got around to it yet. Bob Bell, I think I interviewed him. Bill Appleton, I had a big long chat with him ages ago now. And yes, we covered the Cyberflix days. Bill is a nice guy and quite an interesting character. And he really wanted to make interactive movies. And so after he did World Builder and Supercard with Silicon Beach, he went on and founded a company called Cyberflix. Oh, wrong one. And at one point, he did the Titanic game, and that was, I'm going to sell that equipment. That was like number one or number two on the PC game charts for months.
The Starship Titanic, the sci-fi one?
Or no, the
the movie
Titanic. The Titanic game, like you go on board the Titanic ship. I think it's a time traveling theme. It's like an adventure game.
Wow.
trying to do that interactive movie thing. Why did I just take that mission? I don't know where it is. Oh, over there. See, I'm too distracted while I'm talking. I have talked to Ray Dunican. He did four world builder games. Ray's Maze mm-hmm. was his first one mm-hmm. Back in 1990. Wow, I think it just started hailing outside my room. So Ray Dunican's a really interesting guy because he came into games from, what's that arrow? See the arrow on the map here? Is that just telling me, hey, the planets are over there?
Yeah, I think it's pointing back to the middle in case it's sort of if you get lost.
Yeah, I was just saying, Ray came into games after he bought a computer for his son.
Mm-hmm.
And before that, he was doing graphic design, and he actually started his career doing airbrushing of t-shirts.
Oh, wow.
Gotta get closer. I hate these tiny little ones. They're so hard to land on.
Yes. Sorry.
T-shirts.
T-shirts. That's very strange. Now, who buys those, I wonder?
I don't know. I'll carry 10 tons of them. Just
10 tons of T-shirts is a lot of T-shirts. We'll find out.
Let's go there again. So we've got a lot of stuff over here, I believe. And Ray's games are a beautiful puzzle adventures. Some very sophisticated scripting mm-hmm. went on with his design. Who else did people mention? Charlie Jackson. Yeah, I talked to Charlie. I also talked to Eric Soker, Mark Pierce, John Gay. So I've covered most of the Silicon Beach guys.
Mm-hmm.
There's no planets in here, is there? How do I get there? This way or the other way? Do you remember?
I've made it tough. I don't remember. It's sometimes the connections are.
I'll try this way.
Yeah. Someone's fighting. That didn't last long. They waited to have their little battle until you showed up and the NPCs were created.
John Calhoun's been an interesting one to interview. It's the glider games I loved.
Oh, me too.
Let's buy some metal. I think maybe it's the glider. Other way to get to this place. We seem to be going away.
I played a lot of glider. I played a lot of world builder games. We had, for a time, we had AOL, and the arrangement was you'd get one free hour a month, and then it was something like $12 an hour subsequently, which, you know, 20, 25 years ago was a ton of money, and it's just still a lot of money for internet access. And so I would use 2 to 3 hours total of internet per month, and I couldn't really afford much more on my allowance and my parents' indulgence. So I would spend time downloading, among other things, World Builder and HyperCard games. Off the top of my head, the one that I played a lot of was actually pretty good ripoff of the movie 2001 as a HyperCard game. Amazingly had recorded audio from the film, which I thought was, you know, very high production values. There you are.
A lot of mech. Oh, what do we have here? Another. That's what called Quake.
I have a Quake story. Okay. When I was in college, there was a girl who lived on the same floor of my dormitory building who played a lot of Quake. She was super into Quake. Fuel,
so I'm going to head back this way.
So I knew this girl who was super into Quake, and she was a year ahead of me. Well, it turns out her name was Stephen Case, and she ended up getting married to, I can never keep them straight, was it John Romero or John Carmack? John Carmack. I guess she was so into Quake, she ended up getting married to the Quake guy. Oh, there's your t-shirts again.
Yeah, I just went back to the previous planet because I was getting low on fuel.
Mm-hmm.
And I wasn't sure what was coming ahead. The chat's been moving so fast that I've not been able to keep up.
Oh, I wish I could see it.
You probably can. I don't know.
Well, I'm not a computer. I suppose I could.
You might be able
to log into my own stream.
Yeah, you might be able to just pause the video and on there and just look at the chat. I'm not sure.
I'm gonna find your link on Twitter, and I'm gonna see if I can join the chat from my other machine. This might cross the streams and destroy the universe. We'll find out. Or I'll drop my laptop on the floor. Okay. See if I can make this work. Aha. Okay. So I'm in the chat now. Who am I? I don't have an account.
Is there another?
So if I just type test, oh, it wants me to. All right, I have to sign up for Twitch. Hang on.
Am I missing something here? There are two worlds on this. Or do I need to re-land or something? Oh, I think I see. We're getting a bit of money together now.
Yeah. Hang on, I'm verifying my email address, and then I'll be right there.
Do I have a RAM scoop?
There we go.
I don't think I do. No, I don't. Oh, geez, we need a lot more money if we want a better ship. Sell some metal. Oh shit, oh shit.
Oh, this is for you. Okay, so now.
I was so surprised by that. I didn't have my hands on the keyboard, and then I was panicking. How do I eject? How do I eject?
Killed you right away.
Yeah.
Is this an opportunity to try one of the other games, perhaps?
One of the other Escape Velocities?
One of the others in the series.
Yeah, why not? I've got them all on here.
Hi, guys. I'm in the chat now, in addition to on voice, and I'm seeing two copies of the shared screen. So I have lots of ways to view EV now.
All right, let's pop into EV override. It needs more memory. All right.
Oh, I remember this dance.
I'm just going to make its preferred size a whole bunch bigger. Let's see if that does it. You can see the stepping up of the production values.
Better music. Now, I will have to say, I have not seen this game for years and years. And this is the one I was, I don't want to say least involved with, but for some reason I have the least memory of it. It's decent music, though.
Mm.
Someone in chat asks about a string that they found while poking around inside the game about Matt's radical cheat mode. And yes, the answer is that probably was just an Easter egg to pull your chain while you were poking around in there. There were a lot of debugging tools and cheats that I used for development, so I wouldn't have to do what Richard's doing and spend my entire life selling t-shirts to make money. But that was all compiled out in the release build, so I'm sorry there is no cheat, other than just editing your pilot file.
You can immediately see it's very busy around Earth.
Mm-hmm. So they reused a number of the planet graphics. So far, it doesn't look that much different. The game engine was a tiny bit improved, but it's really EV Nova where the major improvements got made. Okay, so there was a question about what build environment and machine was used to write these games. Let's see. So the history is, when I was in high school, I wrote an earlier game which got bought for a very few dollars by a publishing company, and they published it under their own name with different graphics and stuff. And I took the, I think I got $1,000 or $1,500 from that, which, when you're a high school student is a lot of money. So I plowed that into I want to say it was a Proforma 630, 68K machine. And I think that was one of the ones where they had the promise that they would add a PowerPC upgrade board, and either they never did or it was so much later that I never was able to get one. But most of EV was written on a combination of, well, later it was written on the Performa 630, and the original sort of draft was written on an SE30 with a color video card. And the development environment was Code Warrior C, if I remember correctly. And the later games, I had a PowerPC, I want to say a 7200, 7500, and then I had a one of the sort of Iceberg Blue G4 machines, which was my last one. But yeah, it really was an SE30. It wasn't even a regular SE30. It was an SE30 motherboard that I built. I bought a board from a computer shop, and I built it into a regular AT size PC tower case, kind of cobbled it together. And then I put a color video card in it. And then I had it on a VGA monitor externally. So it didn't even look like a Mac. It was kind of a home-built Mac back in the days when this was kind of a thing that we did. That was a cool machine. I think it had 8 megabytes of RAM. It was amazing. Yeah, and actually the video card poked out of the case. So I cut a hole in the case for the video card to poke out of, and then I had I think it was one of my dad's friends welded an addition onto the side of it. So it was this really ugly looking computer that had a big bump in the side because I couldn't get the video card to fit in. I spray painted it all black. So that was my sort of monolithic Macintosh. Dead again.
I tried to eject, or I guess I was too slow. Or I don't know. Can you even eject without the ejector thingy?
Yeah, I guess if you don't have the escape pod, you can't do it.
Yeah. Should we go to Nova now?
Yeah, you might as well. You might as well. That didn't work out well for you. There was a question. Did you use SAT for EV? That, I think, is a reference to a code package called the Sprite Animation Toolkit. And the answer is yes. The first two games did use SAT. And the guy who wrote that toolkit, I can still remember his name 20 years later. It was Ingmar Ragnarmalm. It's one of those lovely names. The third game did not use SAT. It used a different package, which I think I mostly wrote solo. But the first two games, EVO used almost the same game engine as EVNova. There were some minor tweaks, but EVNova was substantially upgraded, and the graphics quality really improved. The Atmos guys, Dave and Phil and Jason, all those guys just did a tremendous job with the graphics of this, I think. But I'm not artistically gifted, so.
Now, I definitely have Nova registered on one of my machines. Where's the menu?
I see Mr. Zach, or Mr. Xzach, I never knew, in chat. Howdy. Yeah.
So sadly, the Atmos guys kind of had a falling out while they were making this game.
Yeah. They were pals, and they kind of went into business together, and it was challenging at times. They had some personal
when I click, it's not working.
What has happened?
I'm going to try.
That's not great. I really have not been in touch with any of those guys for a long time, except for Dave Williams. He and I follow each other on Twitter.
And Dave's the one who got me onto you, actually.
Yeah, right. Really, this is a very familiar experience to me. I'm looking at EV and talking to Australians, which is really what I did for several years. So really nothing's changed in my life. Oh, I'm sorry. It's Mrax. It's not Mr. Zach. So It's not particularly phonetic, you have to admit.
It doesn't seem to be working here. Maybe I can... Yeah, I can use keyboard shortcuts. Oh, there's an upgrade. You can have nicknames and pick your gender now.
Oh yeah, and there were entire alternate missions that would only come up for female characters that they added. I thought that was a really cool idea. I can't remember
just any of them. The hell of it. I'm gonna change
Kate,
things
Kate
up.
Kate could be a lady's name. I mean, that's just...
yeah. Nickname, Maverick. I guess that's okay.
She could be. Hey, it's the 29th century. I mean.
Okay, and now to enter. Maybe that. Yep. Okay, I guess the keyboard shortcuts. Clicking on things wasn't working.
So we have text now, but it's we have actual little graphic. I want to say insets.
Some weird alignment.
Higher production values all around.
Some of the alignment is not so great, though.
Oh, the kerning.
Yeah. And that middle bit of text should really be lined up better with graphics as well.
Yeah, I don't disagree.
Oh yeah, this is very ugly.
I don't know what that font is.
Having done a little bit of layout and design work before, this is kind of painful to look at.
Oh, it's making Richard's eyeballs twitch, so we better click through.
But once again, you got a very involved story, and these guys spent a lot of time fleshing out their universe.
Oh, absolutely they did. It's almost the wrong medium for what they wanted to do. I mean, here's a game that's basically... Oh, come on, look at the blinking lights and the jet exhaust and the ships that kind of fade off into the distance. You must be in a nebula or something.
Big step up in the visuals at this point.
It's much better. But, I mean, even that, just the introductory, you know, tutorial mission is, you know, 500-word essay. It's almost the wrong medium for what they wanted to do. They wanted to tell a novel. And it's probably a valid criticism of this game that it tries to tell you too much rather than letting you do stuff. It's an amazing change from the first one, where it's basically they're good guys, they're bad guys, they don't like each other. Okay, here's the universe. And they did a tremendous amount of story creation and you know, populating. But it's just a different kind of experience. Oh, you were an innocent victim.
Yeah.
There's a question in the chat. Have I played Artemis? And if so, do I think of it? I have not heard of it, so I guess not.
Let's try that again. Okay, flying this way.
Chat question. Were the assets for the games created with the same tools afforded to plugin creators? Yeah, I don't believe that there was any special mission editors or anything.
Jesus.
Wow. well,
maybe
you're
should...
a filthy pirate.
Okay, I'm gonna look up my registration info and see if I can
registration.
See if I can get this version registered. I don't know what the keyboard shortcut's gonna be then. Maybe that'll just be a web link, won't it? Oh, maybe.
No, I think that is where you enter your code. $30. It's amazing that they haven't changed the price in all these years.
All
That
right.
seems
Give me a moment. I'll see if I can find it.
odd.
Oh, hang on. If I go to my Ambrosia account, it'll be there too.
Yes.
I was trying to find it in my email, and then I just realized. Do them both at the same time.
There's some talk in the chat about what is the current status of Ambrosia, and you'll have to read chapter 37 of Richard's book to get all that background dirt.
There's not quite that many chapters,
Well.
but yeah, I have talked to Andrew Welsh, and basically what it comes down to is that he got sick of being a manager. Okay, I found my license code. Think I can, yep. Now the whole world can use my license code.
Well,
That's great. Maybe I can get one.
oh, it's probably trying to invoke a browser that no longer functions.
I'm going to check the website account.
Sorry, folks, it's live TV.
Can't believe it expires. Oh, there's a more recent version of Nova available as well. Yeah, I'm not really that concerned about people seeing my license code for the game. It's not like you can't pirate it easily enough.
Right.
Anyone honest about it will pay. Set the system clock back.
Ooh.
I can try.
Clever.
I'm just gonna go back a few years. See if that works.
Wonder what happens if you call their phone number. Is it just ringing at Andrew's house or?
Don't know.
What a shame.
Yeah, the code that I'm seeing online is the same, and I can try installing the update, but I don't know. I don't think that would fix it.
I don't think so. The registration interface was a code library that was provided by at this point in history, it was probably provided by Matt Slot of Ambrosia, and I sort of just dropped it into the game. So that's it all kind of accesses this third-party block of code that they manage, and it accesses their servers in their kind of custom way. They're talking about the EV trading card game. Yes, there was an EV trading card game. It was not an official Ambrosia product. There was some entrepreneur who had an idea to create it, and I think their business model was to create collectible card games out of kind of, you know, low-hanging fruit, intellectual property. And I don't know that I ever got, well, I can't say that I never got a dime of it, but I don't remember getting any or much compensation from that. And I'm not sure anyone ever bought a copy of it, but I have somewhere stored in a box, I have two or three starter sets and some booster packs of the EV collectible card game, and a couple of, I think, very rare collectible EV Nova mouse pads that were made in conjunction with that. I'll tell you who else has an EV Nova mouse pad. It's Randall Monroe, the guy who draws the XKCD comic. I got into an email conversation with him a couple of years back, because he name-checked Evie Override in one of his comics, and so I wrote him and I said, hey, thanks. And he told me that he played Evie games as a kid, and he's of course a big mathematician, real math nerd, and yeah, he told stories about being a young guy and trying to compute the odds, or trying to reverse engineer what math I was using to figure the odds of capturing a ship. And so I actually went back and I dug the source code off of the CD, and I told him, well, it's actually, you know, the ratio of the two ships' crews plus a random number plus some other factors. And I sent him a, you know, being a big fan of his comic, I sent him one of my few treasured Evie Nova mouse pads that I had. Well, they're not really treasured, but they're rare. And I never heard from him after that. So I don't know, maybe he's just too overwhelmed with joy about his mouse pad. But if anybody knows Randall, see if he's using his EV mouse pad or not.
What is the Nova app in? Might have stripped the resource fork.
Uh-oh. It doesn't look like an app anymore.
Let's try opening this again after I've set the system clock back.
Uh-huh.
If I could stream from one of my PowerPC laptops, I would, but They're G3 models, and it would be kind of slow. It still says 129 days. Anyone know where the file is for that?
Somehow it knows. I'm not sure it isn't using the network to... Well, does this emulator even have network? Who knows?
Yeah, it does. File in preferences somewhere. Okay. Does anyone know exactly where I can find it? Let's get rid of that.
I think there's a hidden file somewhere too, right?
How do I find that? I don't know how to show hidden files in OS 9.
also don't remember.
Should I get rid of that too? Wait, things are moving so fast. Okay. Get folder info for preferences? Or do that in ResEdit? Do I have ResEdit installed on here?
The combined forces of the chat are itching to grab your mouse and do it for you. I don't remember how this works. It's been a long time since I used OS 9.
I don't remember if I have ResEdit in here.
Oh dear. Well, we could read Inside Mac Games magazine.
Yeah, we can read old issues.
That's right.
Do I have it here? Okay, resedit.sit. Let's install it. So now what do I do? Do I find escape velocity?
There's a something.log file in, I guess it was probably in the same spot as the preferences file, right?
Navigate to preferences.
There you go. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. So now that I've got rid of that, it should work. Been a long time since I used ResEdit for anything other than looking at a resource fork.
I was not involved in any of the port of EVNova to Windows. And I can only imagine the hoops they had to jump through to get the game to work in Windows, because it's so, I was doing what I shouldn't have done, which was use the resource fork as a database. In the old Inside Macintosh programming books, they said explicitly, don't do that, but I did because it was very convenient. And you could create those ResEdit templates and you were good to go. But it doesn't scale well to other, doesn't port to other OSs very good at all. Oh no, you're busted. Richard, Captain Hector is smarter than us.
So does that mean we're still going to get attacked by him?
You're going to die almost instantly. I'm fearful.
Well,
that's a shame. Well, darn.
I mean, I can uninstall the game. I set the system clock back 3 years. Has it changed again? Maybe I can't do it with networking on. Yeah.
So I'm reading the chat and learning all kinds of interesting facts about the Evinova Windows port. That's amazing. Becky Heinemann. I have never heard that name. Well, or if I have, I've forgotten it.
It used to be called Bill Heinemann, one of the co-founders of Interplay.
Ah.
Yeah, Sheepshaver is syncing with the main computer. I can't find an option to turn off the internet access.
It's probably not internet access. It's probably more like your emulator's the real-time clock hardware it's trying to emulate is actually just grabbing the time from your computer. So if you change your modern computer time, I suppose you'd have trouble keeping that from syncing too.
Well, we can try.
We may actually go back in time.
I don't know what's going to happen here. There we go. I went back to mid-April. Let's see how that goes.
Is that enough if you're 120-some days late?
Probably not. I'm not sure how many days in it sends Hector to kill you.
My recollection is it starts at 30 days and he's pretty weak, and then over the next month or so it gets progressively more difficult to defeat him.
All right,
to escape him.
Let's wait for this to start.
Good.
It says 58 days. Okay, I'm going to go back a bit further.
Okay. Didn't go far enough.
Okay, going to February 18, as someone in the chat said. Let's do it.
Now, how do you figure the breakdown of this live stream goes in terms of gameplay versus audio and shareware setup problems?
That must have been for 15 minutes.
Maybe half and half, yeah.
But shareware was so important to the way Mac gaming survived in the 90s. It's basically you couldn't get a product onto store shelves.
Oh, not at all.
And so the only way was to go online.
Yeah, and the role of the publisher was more important. You know, now Apple just takes their cut of your app and then they put it on their App Store, and it's up to you kind of to promote it. I can tell you that the ratio of publisher to author, revenue distribution is basically inverted from between the Apple App Store model now versus the old shareware model. It's basically turned on its head in terms of what the publisher keeps versus what the author used to get. Right, you're in business now.
Yeah, no Hector chasing me this time. Mm-hmm. I kind of want to stop on this world before I jump again.
So clearly a lot of this is just a lot of fancier skins on top of the same game engine. I mean, the map is more or less the same. But the... just the quality of the sprites is tremendous, I think. And we had more memory at this point to work with, so we were able to do things like, you know, the pre-rendered flashing lights and jet exhaust and all that great stuff.
Did I get that? No. Enter just cancels.
Oh, there's a chat question about my earlier comment. Yeah, what I really meant to say, I was trying to speak and watch Richard fool with the clock at the same time. These days, Apple takes a minority cut of, you know, your Angry Birds or whatever. Back in the shareware days, the publisher would keep a large majority of the fees, and the authors would get a smaller chunk. It's just kind of how it was.
There's a lot more guidance in this version as you get started.
Yes.
The other ones kind of just threw you in here, and this one.
In fact, there are times in this one where it almost won't leave you alone. And you could get missions while you were buying metal, and you could get missions in the outfitter in the shipyard too, which was a little bit more varied than just saying you better meet me in the bar for your next mission. Although there's a ton of that too. Uh-oh, out of gas already. Boy, the starting shuttle in this game has hardly any gas.
Go back energy. And buy some fuel.
Mm-hmm. Even just little... cute things like the little targeting reticles are now animated. Those were fun. There's a question in the chat about the AI for the ships, and there were some improvements in the AI. The Atmos guys really wanted to use some very long range non-guided weapons for some of their ships, the rail guns. And so I had to do some work, I remember, to give the AI a decent chance of hitting you, even though you're, you know, several screens away. So that adds some strategy to it, because if you sit still, they can still hit you. That's a hard math problem to solve in a simple and fast way. There's also some sort of varied AI behaviors, including when they're editing the ships or when they're editing the governments, they can set some flags to have the AI prefer what we call standoff attacks. So instead of trying to get right up close to you and blast you, they would try to stay away a certain distance and shoot you from afar. I think, unfortunately, some of the ships in this game have that flag set when they shouldn't. So there are some ships that only have short-range weapons, or maybe ships that don't have guns that can shoot backwards. And the effect is the player sort of you can just charge at them, and the AI, being stupid, will just turn around, and it looks like it's running away, although what it's actually trying to do is it's trying to retreat to a distance and then shoot at you. But being too slow and not being able to blast you from behind, it actually just it looks ridiculous. I have never played EVE Online. I have seen some of the videos for Elite Dangerous, and that looks really cool. Also for what's the name of that game? It used to be called Enemy Starfighter. It's a Steam game, and now it's called like Tales of the Dying Sun, I think. I saw a Let's Play video on that, and it looks pretty cool. I don't get to play video games that much anymore, but I occasionally watch a Let's Play video while I'm at work. It's as close as I get. And Star Citizen. Yeah, my brother, my little brother, who did, you know, when he was, you know, quite small, did some of the, helped with some of the art for the first EV game. He ended up being a just a tremendous artist, and he does some professional artwork in addition to his normal day job. He did a little bit of work for the Chris Roberts and the Star Citizen guys, and I don't really know what's happening with that game. Every time I read about it, it sounds like, well, it really reminds me of a game called, Richard, you might even know the guy, Derek Smart, I think was his name, with Battle Cruiser 3000. You remember that?
The name rings a bell.
Yeah, it was probably late 90s, and it wasn't really a Mac game per se, but it reminds me of Star Citizen in the sense that they, well, Star Citizen no one's played, but Battlecruiser 3000 promised, you know, basically all games to all people. You could captain a ship and recruit a crew and lead a fleet and conquer planets and fight battles on the ground and have galactic strategy. And it was just going to be, ambitious in concept, and it either, depending on which branch of the story you follow, it either never came out, or it came out and it was crippled, or it was kind of a disaster. So it sort of reminds me of Battlecruiser 3000 when I hear this talk about the Chris Roberts game, which is going to be all those things and more to all people. And yeah, I agree. There were some balance issues with some of the ships in this game that if you did the right things, you could get, you know, an infinite amount of money in a real fast, short period of time. So it's almost sort of the opposite direction. The EV games, the first EV game started a little slow with a lot of grinding, and the EV Nova, if you know what to do to break it, you can almost not have to worry about money. It's amazing I remember that. I told you I hadn't played this for a lot of years, but it's coming back. I do remember so much text here. They had to work to keep the planet descriptions from overflowing the description box there. I think this was the first EV game that had scrolling. I had to add scrolling so they could get all their mission text into one dialogue box.
Okay. No, I cannot help.
Yeah, you have nothing to offer. Now we have buildings in Ivanova. That's a graphical step up. I do like that the at least the center of the galaxy map in this one, they kept it quasi realistic in terms of the position of the stars near Earth.
Oh God.
Oof. Oh, that won't last long.
Of the 3D mountains.
Yes.
I remember this tutorial type stuff lasts for quite a while.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it does go on.
It's like, okay, let's go to Earth again. Just keep going back and forth.
Yeah.
We still need to double our money to get another ship.
Oh, yes. Yeah, you have a ways to go.
Yeah, I don't know how much changed between Nova 1.0, which is what this one is, and the newer version.
Oh, my. Yeah. Yeah, there were some tweaks and upgrades, bug fixes, and I think there were even some graphical tune-ups too, I think. Gosh, this does go on and on. But it doesn't leave you nearly as confused as it would otherwise. So I guess maybe that is good. Okay, bye.
Okay.
So is this just a... unemployed old guy who has nothing to do but travel around the universe and tell you how to fly your ship?
I guess so.
I guess not. All right. He's just a crazy guy.
He's a drug mule.
Yeah, I agree. He is a drug mule. Yeah, he's. Yeah, you need to check under the floorboards of your ship now. I'd recommend.
Well, anyone have any recommendations what to do now? Something interesting that won't get us killed immediately. It's like I'd get into some combat, but I know I'll just die straight away.
The icons, even the little equipment icons are better. It's just prettier to look at.
All right, they're both the same payment. Let's see. Wait, are they in the same place? Yeah, same system.
Hmm.
But I can only take one of them. Oh.
no space. Darn. Oh yeah, that's right. There's a system where there's two neighboring planets that sell something that are cheap on one and expensive on the other, so you can just run back and forth and make all your money that way. But I don't remember where that is.
I forget.
Off the northern branch leading from Earth, he says. So,
Well, above New England, we have a delivery to New England.
Okay, you'll find it.
I can't get there through here, can I? Anything besides a battery pack?
That's expensive. Those must be Tesla batteries. I bet you could sell your laser. Or maybe it won't let you. Maybe if you scroll up.
Here's the thing that it does the gradual build up.
Great.
It changed the name so I couldn't find it.
they gave it a prettier icon, and sure enough.
Let's buy that.
If you scroll up, can you sell your laser? I don't think it's going to do you any good. Yes.
I can.
You can make five.
We have a little bit more money now. Maybe buy a battery. It's so expensive, though.
Okay, now where?
They said above New England, right?
Yes. Maybe I can. I'll do my part. I'll find you a map online. How about that?
So where do I head from here, guys? To Nesri Prime. Okay. I love the ambient sound effect whenever you dock at some place.
Oh, okay. I can tell you where to go based on what they're saying. So yes, take the one that's in the lower right from where you're at, the southeast direction. Yes. We doing it right, guys? And now go southwest from here. Yeah, so that's apparently the system where the game-breaking economic feedback loop is located. Little baby pirates, but you can land. Oh, he's no threat.
Yep.
Well, maybe he is.
Okay, made it.
Just makes it more interesting. Okay, so what can you buy? There you go. Oh, so they buy him high. So it's the other planet that has the good stuff. But it's like right there, isn't it? I mean, it's right there. That makes it exciting, doesn't it?
Yeah. Okay, yep. Oops, nice and low.
That's amazing. That's amazing.
Shame there's no shipyard here, though. Well, that's pretty effective.
Yeah. That's not going to take you long. Oh, chat says you don't even need to fly the ship. Just use the number keys to select a planet and then land. Oh, too far away.
Close. Oh, we had to move a tiny bit.
Yeah.
So probably need
no shipyard, though, so you'll have to upgrade.
Escorts.
Oh, yes. Oh, that's right. You can hire some freighter escorts, right? And then fill
no
them
ships
all up.
Available, oh. That one.
Oh.
And there's no bar here.
Might want to run to another planet or another system. Maybe you can hire a freighter and you kidnapped an old man. That's amazing. Is he taking up space? I don't think so.
No. Doesn't seem to be.
Can't do anything.
Any missions that'll take us nearby? No.
It's a good question. Where is Barry during all this? I mean,
maybe he's just sitting next to me.
Yeah, I think so. I envisioned the shuttle being sort of the size of a Ford minivan. So he must just be next to you. He's in your bunk when you're flying the ship.
All right, we can buy a better shuttle. Only has a
12.
Tiny increase in capacity.
That's not great.
Might as well save up some more money.
Yeah. I would. Or just hire some freighters to come along with you. Cargo drone, how much do those carry? 5 tons, okay, well.
15. That carries a lot.
So there was someone in chat is talking about in some of the missions, a passenger weighs 1 ton. Well, of course, we have a resolution problem. We couldn't resolve individual kilograms. And I always assumed, you know, if someone is going to hang out in my cargo bay for an extended period of time, they're going to bring some accommodations with them in addition to their luggage and, let's say, their spacesuit and their space food. They'll have to have some kind of a pressurized module that could easily add up to a ton, metric or otherwise, future tons. So yeah, that's right. How do you know that they're not future tons? They're smaller than regular tons because of it's the future. Or they're hoarders. I also like that explanation. I would accept hoarding. You have a little fleet now. That's neat.
That's much more effective. Do that a few times, we'll have some money.
You're going to have to remember to pay your income taxes and all these opals you're selling. Save your receipts.
We have a problem. Anything I can do?
Your ship is disabled. The only thing you can do, assuming they don't kill you, is beg for mercy, but I'm afraid your number's up here. Well, maybe not.
I think so.
Oh, what a bastard.
Bastards.
But his friend is still going to steal everything. The cold, uncaring universe. That's not a bad deal. Uh-oh. He might get blown up before he can help you. And you already used PayPal to send him your money, so he's already got it. He just left. Oh, that guy took your $2,000 and buggered off.
Oh, you bastard. 18,000 credits.
I'm in a bad mood, so it's going to cost you. Wow.
Yeah, my escort died.
Man, he has you over a barrel, though. I mean, there's nothing you can do.
I'm just sitting here floating in the galaxy watching the asteroid go by.
Now, it can't have been a very complicated repair if he was able to do it all just with what he could carry in that little spaceship.
Yeah.
You know, he might have a screwdriver in there.
Well, unfortunately,
I don't know if this game is that realistic, guys.
Unfortunately, we just spent all the money that we made.
We did. Oh, now the cops are here, too. That would have been helpful. Oh, life is tough in this cold universe.
Yeah, I don't think we're going to get much further if pirates are going to get us. I'm out of here.
Oh, they're fighting each other, though.
Yeah, I got caught in the crossfire last time.
Yes, you did.
I do not know where enlightenment is. Soul, Seti.
I still have the map open in a tab.
Which way is
here.
Seti from Soul?
Need to find it. It is southwest and then southwest again. Do I have that right? Well, according to the map I'm looking at, so it's the south southwest, not that one. Yes, that one. I'm cheating. I'm looking at an online map. It's like Nintendo Power Magazine, but for 1990s Macintosh shareware games.
Stuffed nup nups.
I'd like to know more about that.
Okay, let's buy some. And which world do I go to?
That is a big planet. That is maybe the biggest one in any of these games. Wow.
Livestream rocket boards. Unable to land. There's only three places here though, right?
Oh no. That's a... So did they do anything?
No, or they just not yet. So where do I go now? Where do I smuggle them to?
Southwest, according to the map. I don't know what you're going to do when you get there, but chat says that's the place to go. Did I get it wrong? Is that not the right location?
Oh, crap. Someone's saying northwest. Should I go there instead? No, Zion's the one. Hopefully I won't get attacked this time. Shit.
Those space cops are not at all... Oh! Wow, life is cheap in the galaxy. Wow.
Well, got killed again.
Well, you can open your pilot file, I know that. Unless you are on strict. On the other hand, it's getting on towards lateness here on the west coast of the U.S.
Yeah, we've been playing for about 2 hours.
Yeah, this was going to be a 20-minute thing, but we frittered away at least 20 minutes trying to... be able to load the game, so we won't count that against us. Well, that was fun. What else shall we forget to talk about? So Richard has this crowdfunding campaign. I've already got two copies reserved. You don't get a free copy just for being in the book.
People want to see Harry. I'll open Harry. Exobattle will crash the emulator.
I'm sad about that. I don't have the code anymore either. But I was saying I am excited to read all these cool stories. And this is not a game I've ever played, believe it or not. I know you're really into it, but...
I love the story. Let's just let this run while we're... Oh, what happened? Did I tap something somehow? Okay, I see I had caps lock on. Start that again. There we go. So Harry might actually be making a comeback soon.
Really?
Yeah. Ben Spees is looking at possibly putting it onto the iPad.
Oh, terrific. That's funny. There was a lot of white scrolling text on a black background in these days, wasn't there?
There was a lot of black empty space around the game screens as well.
Well, there is now that we have bigger monitors.
Everyone liked to keep the resolution down to what the crappiest computers had. And they they didn't bother with multiple resolutions, so it was just like force it 640 by 480 blacks black right. border around it.
Right. Actually, the EV games had an advantage there because there was no background, and so the stars can scale better.
I'll check in with Ben and see if he'd be willing to do one of these live streams at some point. I don't know how far we'd get. Harry is a very hard game. But it'd be fun. And you know, that very silly story stuff there was written by a guy who now works for the New Yorker.
Hmm.
I don't know if I can remember the keys for this. And I can remember movement, but I don't know what the keys to do anything are. I want to kick that machine.
Oh yeah.
There we go. Phone tag. So these guys were teenagers when they made the game, and so they'd never actually worked in an office before. All they did was copy Dilbert.
Oh really?
They're just like hoping that Dilbert is an accurate representation of office life.
I have been, my wife and I have been working on building a house, and we're designing it with an architect right now. And so I've spent a lot of the last couple of months looking at floor plans from an overhead view. And so this actually is doing strange things to my brain because.
Oh no, it's locked.
How do I
keep thinking, why would you put a door there? Amazing.
What do I press to change there?
I love the Indiana Jones font also.
Deliver the comet forms to the incinerator. No, kicking people doesn't do anything.
So in later levels, does he obtain weaponry or is he just a chair?
Yeah, you get a staple gun.
Oh, good.
Can also get killed by mailroom guys. And they speed past really, really quickly in the hallways. And soon enough, we'll meet the robot proletariat. They are revolutionaries. I don't exactly remember the way around here, but I seem to be doing pretty well.
Oh yeah.
Mmm, tasty.
So donuts improve your comfort, of course. And comfort is basically your health.
I see. And corporate favor. It's a bit like The Sims in that way. There's lots of stats.
I think I need a key at some point in here, right? Yeah, blue key.
Blue key.
There really was nothing else like this. It's one of a kind.
It's really amazing. This could be a great iPad game.
They've been having some trouble figuring out the controls.
Yeah, controls would be tough. Oh, the stereotypical crushing machine progression. Ooh, uncomfortable. A lot of darts playing in this office.
Yeah, I don't think there's much productivity going on.
It's a big office, though.
Yeah, there's the dangerous mailroom guys.
Mailroom guys.
They will kill you.
They're so fast.
Yeah.
Oh, careful. Ooh, so close.
There's a key. In trouble with this door. But don't tell me it can only be opened from the other side. Ah. Means I have to go the dangerous way.
Oh.
Oh God. Told you those guys are bad. Just takes me there. What an enjoyable pastime.
Watching this, I don't know if this is solely a Mac game or if it was a multi-platform, but do you remember Oids? OIDS.
Yeah, the name certainly rings a bell.
Yeah, it was a bit like Defender plus Choplifter. It was a side scroller. You had a spaceship, kind of a lunar lander thing, and you would land and pick up guys. And there was a pretty active community of level designers, not really mods because there weren't game mods, but man, that was a great game. I need to find a copy of that. FTL games. Oh, it was originally an Atari game, and then there was a Mac conversion. And then an Amiga version. Wow, that's... So they hit the trifecta of obscure platforms. Atari ST, Amiga, and Macintosh. All. Oh. Well, but good. There's an OS 10 version, so that's good.
Didn't mean to do that. Oh well.
Made it. Okay. I gotta get going.
Yeah, we should probably.
One last question. Anyone? Don't forget to back the crowdfunding for an awesome book.
Yeah, the link is right beneath the video.
And no, I'm not getting compensated to say that. I just am excited and I want it to succeed. As I one question, and the question is, how's your wife? What's that supposed to mean? She's at work right now. She was here, and then she left. She is a pharmacy doctor, and she helps keep people from getting killed when they're at the hospital, which is a noble, noble pursuit. So she's off doing that. Chat says, I look forward to reading it. Well, so do I. So this has been real fun. Trip down memory lane, I remembered more than I thought. So thanks, Richard, for setting it up. And
Escape from Jason Wong was a joke game.
Oh, God. Okay, this is where I have to.
I showed Matt this
is where
last
I have
time.
To escape. Yes, I've seen this. So you guys have fun. And thanks, everybody, for still remembering all these old games all these years later. See ya.
So you just go around and you collect these things and the heads try and catch you.
Yeah.
It's really weird.
Yeah.
And for anyone interested, there's the backstory. Yeah, this was fun. Thanks all for coming. I'm going to try to set up another live stream with somebody at some point. I wonder if Jason remembers it. In the meantime, if you know anyone who might want to back the book, give them a nudge. I found this game on a collection of software that somebody sent me. If the campaign fails, my contract with Unbound will be void and I'll be free to figure out another way to get it published. More than likely, I would then go self-publishing because I am capable of doing the design myself. It's just not going to be as good as a professional doing it. If the Unbound campaign succeeds, we'll have a guy called Darren Wall, who is the publisher at Read Only Memory. They've done a Sega Genesis history book, a BritSoft history book. Really beautiful stuff. And if the campaign fails, I won't be able to afford him, so it'll be just me doing it myself, or going through a different publisher, but I'm not sure that they're going to be able to give me terms that are worthwhile. I think you can pledge via PayPal. Any other questions? All right. Well, if I have any, if I need help with doing the design, I'll put word out after the campaign. Hopefully, the campaign will still succeed. But as noted, there's still a long way to go, and there's about a month, just over a month left. Ends towards the end of July. I've been in touch with Jimmy Ma. He wants to know more about the book before he says anything to his followers. Working on getting him some more info soon. Jason Scott is on my list of people to talk to. Frank Cifaldi knows about the book. I don't know if he's done much to help support it. I've been in touch with some other archivists and historians. There's been some support, but they've not managed to get much happening for me. What I could really do with is some big money pledges. Is at the moment we're trending towards needing 750 to 800 backers, which is a lot. But if we could get the average pledge up, then it would, that number would come way down. Next stream, I don't know. I've got to look at my schedule, and I've got to talk to other old Mac people, see who's interested in doing this. But if you follow the Unbound campaign, I will, or follow me on Twitter, I'll keep you posted. Anyone have any other comments before we go? All right, thanks guys. I appreciate the support, and you know, it's a labor of love for me, and obviously you guys are very passionate about it, so I hope I can produce a great book. Thanks for tuning in. Have a good night. See ya.